body language is quite important.
Very important.
Yeah. Does this include hand gestures?
Sure. We pay attention to everything. You know, as a homeopath, we have to do many things at the same time. Eh? Mm-hmm. We have to train ourselves in these skills. So the hand gestures are part of the body language, and body language, of course, is something that we use as information in the context of the patient, in the context of the observation. We trained our students in our CKH basic training, actually, to make this observation, this implicit information, explicit by trying to translate this body language, what they see, what they smell, what they observe, the impression the patient makes, and to translate it into rubrics. Now, in this whole package of information, the hand gestures are part of it. Are they important, more important than the others? It depends. Some patients use hand gestures all of the time. And the way they do it is to emphasize what they are saying. In that case, they're not important. They're like underlined. It's the same importance as raising your voice or using your facial expression to let the homeopath know, now you're saying very important, something very important. So that doesn't make hand gestures more important than just emphasizing the words of the patient. Sometimes the hand gesture says something different than the words. And it's something unexpected. Or some hand gesture is repetitive. It is used for in different occasions, and by saying different things with different meanings, you have the same hand gesture. And because hand gestures are less controlled, body language is less controlled than words, it means they're more important in the hierarchy of symptoms. Because everything that could be controlled loses its spontaneity. And hand gestures is very hard to control. So if we have a discrepancy between the words and the hand gesture, then the hand gesture is more reliable. And of course, we pay attention to it. Some patients don't use hand gestures in the first part of the interview, so then you don't use them. Then you cannot use them. Why? Because they're a little bit, maybe a little bit nervous, a little bit waiting to see what kind of homeopath they have, if they have a good rapport, if they are well understood, if they get all the time of showing themselves. And the hand gestures only come up later by your questioning, because you ask again and again and again, how is this for you? And then they feel like words are not enough. They cannot explain with words, and then the gestures come. And of course, then they are important, because they kind of came to the limitations of their words. And then the body starts to talk, and then it's the vital sensation most likely that will be expressed. So they are not always important, but in general, I consider them as part of the vital sensation and an expression of the vital sensation, if not only emphasis. If they come, as I say, an unexpected and a personal way, these personal gestures. And sometimes, but not always, you have these very beautiful hand gestures that are exactly what you're looking for. But they are kind of rare, so we should not overemphasize the importance.
In the beginning, in the first part of the analysis of the consultation, hand gestures are important if they are not in line with what the patient is saying. So if the context and the content is different than what I understood. Mm-hmm. Can you give an example?
Not only hand gestures, but everything that is in context and content not matching is very important. Ideally, it confirms each other. Then you know what the patient is telling you is exactly what the patient is showing you. And then you know the two aspects of the same thing. And it's confirmed, so it's more reliable. But if you have a different impression of the patient than what he is telling you, for instance, let's say the patient says, oh, you know, I'm relaxed. In general, I'm a relaxed patient. I'm very cool. New situation, I don't care. You know, I just go through the motions. And you see, what you observe is somebody is very tense. You see this facial expression, these muscles are tense, or he's biting his lips, or the way he sits there is quite stiff. Then what you see and what he's telling you is different. You know what he's telling you is what he's trying to make you believe, or trying to make himself believe that he is or he wants to be, which is a compensation. And then one could say that he can't help but showing that it is the other way around, that is the contrary of what he's hiding. And then of course the context is more important and more reliable than the content. That's what I mean.
You mentioned already in this first part of the anamnesis, defining the territory, asking okay. open questions, and observation is very important, and that's it. Or is there anything else we have to pay attention to or to do?
Of course, there's a lot of things we have to do. At the beginning, let's say the very first part of the anamnesis, the intake is very important, because it is your first encounter with this patient. And what is individual, what is different in this patient than any other patient will struck you most when you see him for the first time in the beginning of the consultation, because very soon you kind of get used to your patient and you feel like, I kind of know what kind of person this is. And already you're accustomed to the patient and you're not so much surprised. And it's your surprise which equals strange and peculiar. We have to, as homeopaths, be very sensitive to this individual thing and let the self surprise, like, this is strange. Oh, I never seen this before. These small things. And this is most outspoken in the beginning. So we should never try to make a normal patient or a common patient, because everybody's special. Everybody who walks in is special, and we try to find this, we find words, we find this pattern behind this being special individual. So yes, we do a lot more in this first 15, 20, 25 minutes of the consultation. This, a lot of it is context, as I told you, the impression the patient makes. It's very important the way he presents his symptoms, and mostly his chief complaint, not always, but his chief complaint is physical, is pathology. So of course we have to pay attention to the physical pathology, because this will tell us what kind of case we have. Is it serious physical pathology? Is it organic disturbances? Is it only functional disturbances? Only functional can be quite disturbing, but it's not that serious. Is it a mental emotional problem? So what level is the problem? Is it a common problem? Let's say we see a lot of patients with eczema, or with migraine, or with sleeping problems, or with allergy problems. These are, for us, quite common patients. But we do have patients with strange or uncommon or unrecognized or unexplained diseases. So this is in itself a strange and peculiar case, or a difficult case, or a case of long-standing, or a very serious case with very serious pathology. All this will be clear in the first 15 minutes. What kind of case we have, what kind of person is presenting with this problem, the way he is presenting this particular problem. So we have to check this chief complaint, and we shouldn't, in the beginning probably I already told you, we shouldn't ask any suggestive question. We should only follow the patient, whatever he wants to tell us, and not be very careful not to direct him, because any direction we push him in is something that we often do, but we lose the spontaneous information, and this is a risk of making the case instead of receiving the case. This is very important, that we should not choose a word and then ask more about this word, because this is already pushing the patient in a particular direction. This we shouldn't do in the first part of the interview. We will do it later when we are sure that what we're looking for is there. But if we do this in the beginning, and I often see students making this mistake, they think, oh, I have a sensation, and they immediately ask for more about this sensation. And the patient thinks, well, the homeopath thinks it's important, so he is willing to give you whatever you want to know about it, and he will use all his imagination and everything he can tell you, but maybe it's not important to him. And that is when we make up a case. So this is, again, in the first part of the interview, something we should avoid.
Mm-hmm. You said, nevertheless, pathology is important.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because mm-hmm. the patient comes with pathology, mm-hmm. but we need to know a lot about it. So if you say, ask open questions, how do you match it with the pathology of the patient?
Hahnemann already gave you some hints, although his questions are not always so open about pathology. He gives in a footnote of his aphorism examples of what you can ask about, I think, stool of a patient. It's quite interesting to read how many questions you can ask. I don't say you have to do the same thing, but the idea is there that about something common, let's say like migraine, that you can still ask many, many questions. In the beginning, the patient will look at you a little bit like, you never heard of migraine or what? But you can explain. If the patient needs some more information, you can say, I know, but migraine is different with everybody, so I want to know about your migraine. If you ask the patient, how is your migraine feeling? Of course, they will say, it's painful. That is not a very good question. So you can be even more open and say, tell me everything about your migraine. And then probably they will give you a few common symptoms, like it's very painful, it's on the right, and I feel it coming, and then I know there goes my day. The only thing I can do is go home as quickly as possible, lie in the dark, and wait for the pain to stop. Take painkillers and wait to stop. And then very often the homeopath is a little bit at loss, because all his patients with migraine tell more or less the same. But that's the beginning. Then it's our skill to ask, I see, can you say a little bit more? And even if the patient says, what can I tell you more? You can say, well, how is your pain, for instance? Yeah. So it's still asking more of what you already said. Mm-hmm. The patient said pain, you ask pain. If the patient didn't use the word pain, you can't ask pain. You can say, what is the problem? If they say, I have a problem with, then you say, what is the problem? If they say, it's very painful, then tell me about your pain. If they say, it's a nuisance, tell me about the nuisance. And in this way, we will explore unfold little by little all the details. The patient doesn't know that we want to know all these details. And when it's a chronic problem, they're so used to it. And they live with it for so long that they forget about all the details. They just say, oh, it's there again. And we don't know anything. We have to know what is the it, what is there again. And if they told you everything about it, and you still feel I don't know enough, then you say, how long do you have this problem? And then we have the beginning. Do you remember when you didn't have the problem? When they say, oh, I have it all my life. Okay. You, all your life, you mean as a baby? Mostly they will say, no. But I mean, for instance, migraine when I was studying. And then you can ask, okay, period you didn't have it, period it started. What happened during that time? You know, this is asking for a causation, not what caused your migraine, but at what period in your life this migraine started, because this must have a reason. There must be a reason why a chronic problem started at this particular time. So very often this is from the pathology, and we have like a door that opens to a lot of personal information. And all this is still within the first step of the anamnesis. So we do many, many things. And very often you have a good idea of the direction, sometimes even the kingdom, of your case.
I understand this first part is very important.
Absolutely. Yeah.
We follow the patient where he wants to go. We ask open questions. Mm-hmm. We observe a lot. Mm-hmm. And we get a hunch of the direction, sometimes even of the kingdom. Mm-hmm. Now, how do you get from this first part to the second part.
The second part, being more of the same.
Yes.
Mostly it's spontaneous.
Mm-hmm.
Very often you don't have to do anything but wait. You know, patience is one of the skills of the homeopath, having a lot of patience. And it can take a bit long, we feel, but it's better to make it a bit longer and let it come spontaneously. To not be impatient and try to push the patient into something more personal. Almost always, at least in my experience, when you let the patient talk about his, the reason why he comes, his complaints, there is a moment he goes from my complaint to me, to this complaint and my life. He broadens the subject by himself. He can say, well, this migraine is when I'm stressed, but I've always been a person with a lot of nervousness. And without asking, how are you? And tell me a little bit about your personality and how are you as a person? The patient already told you, I've always been a nervous one. You can let him talk, and later you can come back to it. And in the second part, you said you've always been nervous because you had it. Can you tell me a little bit about this? Only this. Just from this stone, stepping stone, you go to the next. If not, it happens, then you can ask, for instance, and then you help a little bit. I understand that you have a lot of problems with this migraine, and that is really a big problem since you have it so often, and you lose 1-2 days in bed, and it's unpredictable if you can go and make an appointment and even work. And so how it is for you to have this problem? And this is a direct question to level 5, and this is what we always do in anamnesis. Actually, our questions are always aimed at level 5, asking for the experience with whatever problem the patient tells you. And then there's a possibility, every case is different, that the patient says, well, you know, if you have a problem like this, it is, you feel so limited, you feel so obstructed, you can't move forward. Whatever you want to do, there's the migraine again, and then you got blocked. Then you have a very good hint where you're heading. See, you ask something of pathology and they already go into the sensation. And then, of course, it's easy to ask, what do you mean by blocked? You know? And the chance that the door opens is there. By the pathology, maybe you can go into more general things. I would not recommend to, if you don't know what to ask, to say to the patient, well, can you tell me a little bit about your father and your mother? Mm-hmm. I don't think that's a good idea. Because if they don't mention father or mother in the territory, defining the territory, then we're not going to talk about father and mother. If they did, that's a different story. If they say, well, you know, I always get migraine when I visit my mother, then you know there's something with mother. Then your question is legitimate. But if they didn't mention it, if they are married and they didn't talk about their husband or wife, then it's not to us to tell me a little bit about your relationship. Why would we? If they don't mention relationship, then obviously relationship is not a problem. If it's not a problem, why lose time and talk about it? Same thing if it's a mother of 3 children, we know that because we ask, are you married, do you have children? Before we start the consultation, and they don't talk about their children and their motherhood, why would we ask? So this is what I would recommend not to do in the second part. Not broaden the subject by bringing in subjects ourselves, but, and that's why I call it more of the same, only talk about the things we already talked about, and only the words of the patient.
If in this part of the consultation, the second part, the patient is giving more of the same, isn't there a risk that you stay on the same level and can't get deep enough to find the remedy?
Well, I told you before, it's all levels, all of the time. So the vital sensation is in all levels. So we don't have to bring our patient to the 5th in order to have a good prescription. If we can, it's better, and then it's confirmed. But in many cases we can't, and my experience with my students was that if they try to guide their patients to this deepest level of this vital, and the patient has to verbalize this vital sensation literally, very often they are unable. Or the student feels, at the beginning homeopath with his system feels, he failed in understanding this vital sensation or reaching this vital level, and then his whole case was reduced to nothing because he felt he had no valuable information. And that's how one of the main reasons how and why I developed this system in the first place, because in my conviction, and it's what I'm seeing in on a daily basis, the vital sensation is on all levels. So it is in fact not that important on which level the patient is talking, as long as we are able, and that's what I'm trying to explain and to demonstrate by cases, to discern between the vital information on each level and the common information. So that is the main thing. It's not that, oh, it's only level 3 or it's only emotion. That is not the main thing. Even on a pathology level, level 1 or level 1 and 2, you can make a vital prescription as long as you know how to discern.
So how do you do that? How do you know?
That's the main thing, of course. We are homeopaths, so we're always listening for the strange, rare and peculiar information in whatever the patient says, whatever topic, whatever level. So we're always listening to the most individual, the thing never heard before. In the beginning, every migraine will sound the same. I gave you the example of the migraine. When you question more and more, every migraine is different. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're looking for.
Yeah. Now, how is this part then different from the first part? Because the patient is talking about the same things.
Yes, indeed. And I call it more of the same.
Mm? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it is the same subjects, as I said. Is it the same territory? But they will go into more detail. In the beginning, they will sound more superficial. The patient doesn't know you want all those details. The patient lives with this problem, doesn't know that is, doesn't realize that it is different than the others. And of course, because we question them and they give so much information, there is a danger of losing your attention. In the beginning, you're eager to know your person, your patient. It's new and, you know, it's like an adventure. You start this adventure. And then they tell more of the same, indeed. And the danger is that in hearing it over and over again and questioning it over and over again, you start to lose your attention as the consultation goes on. So that's what happens in the second part very often.
Yeah. And then you get lost in the studies also.
Sometimes, yeah, it looks like we get too much information. Mm-hmm. Once the patient starts to tell a story and they feel or they hear or they see that you are interested because you're noting everything down, they are encouraged to tell more and they give you more and more and more, and indeed you can get lost in one story after the other. But the thing is, as a homeopath, we listen to the stories, of course, the stories are important, but with focused attention. And we are, in these stories, having special attention, focused attention for the kingdom information, which is the experience of the story, which is conveyed by the story. That is what we're doing. So we are listening to every single detail, and that's why I say it's so important to know where you're heading. We're looking for specific information.
Mm-hmm. So, actually, you're saying you're looking for the message in the story?
Yes, it is the message in the story, that's how I call it. So there's a reason why the patient tells this story, or all these stories, or all these anecdotes. They can give you a lot, but they are never coincidental. There are millions of possibilities, literally, and every patient of stories, of happenings, of impressions or anecdotes that the patient can tell, yet they pick out a few. And very often they seem even trivial to us. Why tell us this? Patients sometimes come from far and they have to wait a long time and they pay a lot of money and you sit in for a few hours and then they come with such a trivial story, we feel, or such a common anecdote that you almost cannot understand why they come with that particular story. And the reason always is because there is a message in the story, and the message is the vital sensation. It's like the box, or the rapture around the vital sensation. You have to unfold it and see what's in it. So it's never coincidental. Every anecdote, every story is important.
Mm-hmm. Still, you often have the impression with patients, if they come with their stories, there's a lot of information in that it's not useful, or you can't use all these stories that they're telling, even if there should be a message behind them.
Well, I think mostly with patients who had a lot of psychotherapy, mm-hmm. and we do have those patients, yeah. Mm-hmm. or homeopaths, and they analyzed themselves a lot. Or they did it, either they did it in psychotherapy, or they read a lot, or they're homeopaths, so they are trained in analyzing or listening into a particular way. So a lot of the information they give is already rationalized. It's thought about, and it's a product of the mind. And indeed, this is information we cannot use. Mm-hmm. I agree.
Yeah. How do you handle these patients and these patient stories?
You have to know how to handle them. So again, Hahnemann says we have to have a good knowledge of human nature, and I think it is very important. And we need to understand the patient in his context and in his social and cultural background and his biography. So everything that's explicable in this sense goes out of the window. And this could be an important part of your own content. It's not that we cannot use. So the way to handle these patients, of course, is with a lot of patience and without any judgment, with a lot of understanding and compassion. Mm? And we have our skills. We can ask questions, for instance, to help them to leave this comfort zone of analyzing and rationalizing, and by saying, for instance, I understand very well, your analysis is very good of the situation, but how actually did you experience it? So then we make a resume, okay, this analysis is fine, but actually we need something else.
In your book, The Vital Approach, you mentioned that it is very important to note everything that you have, that afterwards you can retrace the portrait of your patient, so fidelity of tracing the information. So mm-hmm. can you tell a bit about that?
Yes, my recommendation is to write everything down. I know patients who talk quickly, I know the problem, sometimes are hard to follow. Yet, with fidelity of tracing the picture of the disease, I mean that you write exactly the words of the patient, not a synonym, not another word, not an interpretation, but exactly the word that the patient used, even when the word is wrong, even mm-hmm. when it's an odd word or misplaced, or you feel like that's a strange way of telling it, because that's exactly what you want. Mm-hmm. So you don't want to make something else of it. In NLP, they say that if we have, if we get information that doesn't match our inner map, we have the tendency to delete, to distort, and to generalize. So as homeopaths, as we are human, we have the same tendency. And throughout consultation, all this information comes. By definition, it doesn't match our inner map because the patient is different. And we try to refine our sensitivity to the difference. That's what we're trying to do. Without any judgment, but just see how the patient is different, how his inner map is different from ours or from a common agreement. So what happens is some information comes to us, the patient tells us something we don't understand, doesn't seem to make sense to us, we don't know why he says this, we don't understand what he means by this expression, so we don't write it down. This means delete. Later, if you go through your dossier, to your notes, and I had this occasion many times with my students, I said, did you hear the patient said this, that, and that, and a very particular way of putting this. And then the students go like, did he say this? It's not in my files. So it's not even noted. Why? Because they couldn't make sense of it. That's not a reason to delete it. That's the very important reason to note it down, because what you don't understand is the remedy. It's by definition the remedy, because it means it's different, it's strange, it's individual, it's rare, it's what we're looking for. Now, distort is the thing we do when we don't quite understand, but we make something of it that we do understand. So we twist it a little bit, and then it matches. It's like it doesn't go in our inner box, and we push a little bit, and then it will fit. But it's not what the patient said. So it is a distortion of what he said, and it will yield to the different and a wrong remedy, for sure. Because again, what we're doing is, and that's what we all do, and we have to train ourselves to be aware of that, that we make something unknown into something known. Because we feel so uncomfortable of being in the unknown. And of course, this is the job of the homeopath. Keeping yourself in this unknown place where you don't know who you have before you and what is the experience you don't know of the patient in front of you. And it can be a bit uncomfortable. On the other hand, you could relax because the patient will tell you anyway. You don't have to know before he told you. But staying in this space of not knowing can be uncomfortable, especially when it takes a bit long. So you, as the consultation evolves, you like to get in your comfort zone of knowing. So you distort it a little bit, and then you have the feeling, I know, but for sure mistake. Generalize is making something special, something common, by explaining it. Oh, the patient said this because of... And you explain it, but the patient didn't explain it that way. So you give an interpretation, and it makes it general and common, like everybody would do this in this situation. By doing this, you lose a symptom. And maybe it's a very typical thing for the patient. But you made it, instead of typical and rare, you made it general and common, and there it goes. So we have to watch ourselves. And that's why I say, write everything down as literally as possible. And then afterwards, if you go through your files, normally the pattern of the disturbance should be in your files.
Mm-hmm. Okay, to summarize.
Yeah.
Second part is more of the same. This means that even though apparently the patient is repeating himself, you have to keep yourself focused mm-hmm. on certain information so that you have a true picture of whatever he says. And you have to write it down carefully and accurately. So at the end, if you have listened well with focus to the message behind the story, then is it then that you can come to a remedy?
Very often, yes. Sometimes you have a very good hint in the first part of the interview. Mm-hmm. Very often, you know the kingdom in the first step. When the territory is defined, very often, then you know what kingdom you are in already. Not always, but mostly at the end of step two, yes. Sometimes step three is not even necessary. By that time, you already have enough information to know you're a mineral kingdom. You know the one column, so there's nothing more to ask. Although we usually still ask for fear and dreams to confirm. That's why I call it the step three of confirmation. Sometimes it's necessary because we miss a lot of information. Maybe we know kingdom, but we're not sure yet. And then we hope that our last questions, our last cards we have, that fears and dreams, hobbies, fascinations, sensitivities will give us the final result.
Why fears and dreams?
Of fears and dreams, that's a good one, because they're level 4 unconscious mind. So the conscious mind is what we discussed, we get these rationalizations. These are not very useful, but the unconscious is everything we try to hide for ourselves. And we mostly control in daily life. Except our fears are very hard to control. Everybody has irrational fears. And our dreams are uncontrollable.
How do you bring this up with the patient after he has told all these stories and giving you all this information to go to that field, unconscious field, actually.
That's not that hard. By that time, you maybe questioned the patient, or we talked with the patient already 1 hour, 1 hour and a half, maybe. So you will have enough hints. The patient will have told you so many things, and you can pick out a word or an anecdote, for instance. And it comes naturally. For instance, the patient already said in the beginning, I'm afraid of talking in public. Then at the end you can say, you said you're afraid of talking in public. You have any other fears? So it comes very natural. You pick out a fear and you ask anything more. Or the patient said, when I'm stressed up, I have a disturbed sleep and I wake up 3-4 times a night. And then you say, do you wake up in dreams when you have a restless sleep? Or so you always have a hint somewhere. It doesn't sound unnatural, like now for something completely different. It's not like that.
Still, there are patients who will say that they're not afraid of anything and they don't dream.
Yes.
So,
yes, they're a bit rare. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the first thing you can do is look like, really? I mean, push them a little bit, like everybody has fears. No fear at all, you mean not one? Mm? And the same with dreams. Of course, you do it kindly, like, really, never in your life? No dream? Not one? Not as a child? No scary dreams? No funny dreams? You can try everything. Eh? And sometimes they will come up and say, oh, actually, yeah. Now I remember once, and then the one dream that you need will come up. Mm-hmm. Some patients won't tell you that they have a fear. They have no fears. And even if you look like, no fears, mm-hmm. Wow, this is rare and peculiar, they will go, no, I'm not the fearful kind. So these are heavily compensated patients, because everybody has some fear somewhere. And maybe they don't call it fear, they call it a worry, or they call it an anxiety, but they will have a fear here or there. It's human. And but if they deny, when it's compensated, then you can try, but they won't give it to you directly. The only way you can try then is indirectly. So you can put another question. You can say, okay, no fears then. But anything maybe in general, maybe on television or a movie you are sensitive to, something in the outside world, not in your personal world, the outside world, and then might say, well, I don't like to, for instance. Not I'm afraid of. But for instance, I don't like to see whatever, people parachute jumping or something. And then, you know, fear of heights, of course, it's simple. Eh? Mm-hmm. Or they want, maybe they will criticize people. I think it's stupid to bungee jumping. I don't see the use. Okay, you have a fear. So it can come in a masked way. It can come indirectly. Eh? Or you can ask about other people. They don't have to tell about themselves. Like I said with pupils, they don't like to open up themselves, they talk about others. But this is the last thing we can try. Something in the outside world where we try to find the projection of the very compensated patient. That again is an amazing skill. And we have a lot of compensated patients. And this gives information in the sense that we ask ourselves, who needs to compensate so heavily? Because the amount of compensation is similar to the vital sensation. Must be intense. Otherwise, there wouldn't be a need to compensate or to hide. So it's indirect information. And maybe it's even better and clearer, and that's why I'm doing this, by life cases. That's why I demonstrate this with life cases, because then you can point to all the compensating behavior throughout the case.
So even in these cases of compensated patients, at the end of the consultation, at the end of step 3, you are able to prescribe remedy?
You should, yes. I mean, that's the ideal. If the anamnesis is well done, then you get the picture, the pattern. This means that all you wheels point into the same direction, they all point to the same remedy or to the same group, or at least you have enough characteristics to know what you're looking for, and then you can go to your Materia Medica and your books and your software to see if you find a match.
So, you see, the principles of the vital approach are quite simple. Now, all you need is practice and practice and practice. Of course, you can always consult the schemes in the RADAR Opus program and reread the book, The Vital Approach. The best, of course, is to attend the classes with live cases, of which you can find the program on Anna Vervaeke's website. In the meantime, do come back for the next session, where we will shed some light on snakes and spiders and how to differentiate between them.